Thank you, Matthias, and thank you, everybody. So it's very unusual for me to talk at a conference that at the same time I organized, but at the same time it was so easy to organize this one. Maybe, okay, at least my some contribution. So it's my second time in IPEM. I remember very, very vividly the first time because it was the first time I traveled abroad after my first daughter was born. So that was a very, very special event for me. So to my talk, I decided, kind of since I'm starting off this conference, kind of introduce the topic, where it come from. So it's a more of an overview talk, though there is a lot on the research as well. So understanding machine learning via exactly solvable statistical physics models. So just two slides on the motivation. Where do we stand? You all are here because you realized, as everybody else, that deep learning brought some unprecedented, you know, progress and success into machine learning that mostly have been empirical or engineering one, but there are really impressive things that happened in the, say, past 15 years. But there are still some questions open, so I like to put it, you know, take a snapshot from this paper that I have read recently about the questions about machine learning. So I think it's pretty much, you know, in these three lines, what are the things that we are not understanding about how machine learning or deep learning in particular works. So we don't really understand why the heavily parameterized neural networks don't overfit the data, why the traditional kind of bias variance trade-off is not really an issue here. We don't also understand what is the effective number of parameters that we really need for the learning to be possible, which translates to the number of samples that we need for the learning to be possible. So this is something that would be worth understanding better. And, you know, about something like the dynamics of the algorithm, of the learning algorithm, the backpropagation, we don't really know why it doesn't have head for poor local minima, etc. What's striking about this article is that even though I read it only recently, it actually comes from, oops, I should kind of get friendly with this thing. It comes from an essay called Reflections After Refereeing Papers for NIPS by Leo Breiman 25 years ago. So even though a lot happened in those 25 years, you know, progress-wise, and also things happen on the theory side, you know, these questions are still the relevant questions and they are not answered, so the progress was not so impressive on the theory side. The, you know, all the kind of concepts were there back then. So with that, you know, why is it so difficult to make a progress on the theory side? Or why hasn't been done yet? So the way I like to put it is to say, because it's about the interplay of three ingredients that in the existing fields are often considered separately. So let me walk you through that. So these three ingredients here, the way I put it is the structured data, the type of the structure you have in the data, is the architecture of the neural network, and is the algorithm you are using to train it. So why I insist on these three ingredients together? Because say that you kick out one of them, so let me tell you why then you cannot explain why machine learning works, right? So if you kick out the algorithm, well, then you are in the world where things are maybe possible, but you don't know whether they are exponentially costly in the size of the system or not. So you have to consider the algorithm explicitly because you cannot put aside the fact that some problems are computationally difficult, and so we need to distinguish between the ones that are tractable and those that are not. So the algorithm has to be there. You have to take into account the structure in the data. Why? Because if you didn't, then from the point of view of computational complexity theory, we know that even very simple functions for very simple neural networks are NP-complete to be learned for worst-case data. So you cannot be considering worst-case data because in that case, we know that the problem is computationally hard. The data in which we are interested and on which we saw this impressive success are definitely not worst case, but we have zero understanding of what is kind of the magic property of the data that makes the problem tractable. We know that on the worst case, it would not be tractable. So we cannot put that aside. We have to model and consider the structure in the data. And finally, the architecture, why cannot we be kicking this away? here I mean, why cannot we be considering something that is not multi-layer deep network? So that's largely due to the kind of overwhelming empirical evidence, right? We see that the best performing methods are deep neural networks. So we don't really know why shallow neural networks couldn't do the same. Maybe they can, but we don't know how to do it yet. So it kind of makes sense to consider the current architectures that are working to try to understand those. So I said that these, you know, this is kind of very approximate, but when you kind of think of the subfields of, say, computational sciences that consider the question of learning, they kind of naturally divide between these three directions, right? So the computer science and optimization theory would be studying the algorithms, and the structure of the data would be kind of studied in statistics and signal processing and information theory, and the architecture that would be the object of approximation theory and learning theory, and kind of there is really nobody that would be sitting in the middle yet. And this needs to be done. People need to talk together. So if you know, yeah, there is an interesting related kind of set of ideas in a talk by Elhanan Mossel this summer in Deep Learning Bootcamp in Simons Institute in Berkeley, if you're interested in that. So with that, this is really going to, okay, one click at a time. So where is the physics here? Because most of the people in this audience are physicists, like, so why are we here? So we are here because of this long-lasting friendship between machine learning and statistical physics. So the way I like to illustrate it is to show you this Facebook post by Yann LeCun. So Yann LeCun was supposed to be starting this workshop, but he's arriving only afternoon. So I at least take this from his Facebook from about a year and a half ago, after he lectured at a conference we organized in Carges in France that was called Statistical Physics and Machine Learning Back Together. And after that, he posted on Facebook, he said, there is a long history of theoretical physicists bringing ideas and mathematical methods to machine learning, neural networks, probabilistic inference, such problems, etc. Then, you know, he gave some history and that, you know, it kind of was an interest, and then either people left to neuroscience or left completely. And then he's saying, with the prevalence of deep learning and all the theoretical questions that surround it, physicists are coming back. And he said, that school is for them, and we could say this workshop is for them or for us. And he was illustrating it in his talk by telling us about this conference in another wonderful conference place in France, Les Ouches, but that time was not last year, but 35 years ago. And he attended this conference. Here I just give you a snapshot of some of the people. There is a proceeding, so there is a paper by Yann LeCun, and, you know, for instance, Marc Mézard, who will be here later this week, and some names, other names that surely you recognize. And Yann LeCun was saying that back then he was interested in neural networks, and almost nobody wanted to talk to him about that. It was not a thing yet, except the physicist. So that's why he went to this conference. You know, he was very happy that there were interesting things happening. So from very early on, there was an interaction. So how are we kind of approaching this understanding deep learning thing? So this is kind of an intermezzo slide, which to any physicist is quite obvious. But when I give like similar talks in, say, STAT or computer science department, this is something important to remind. It's the way we kind of see what the model is in physics and what the model is, how it is seen in data science or statistics, right? Because in data science or statistics and computer science, models would be kind of the ansatz we use to fit the data, right? In physics, I would not call that a model, I would call it an ansatz. For instance, when I do linear regression, the fact that I'm fitting a line through the points, so function with two parameters, that's an ansatz, but in statistics, that's called a model. But in physics, it's quite different. Model is kind of the main tool for us to understand something, right? So we all know about the Ising model, and we know how it kind of explains the magnetism. And we also know that magnetism is a lot about the electrons and about how they interact in the material and about the quantum mechanics, right? And none of that is in Ising model. And yet it kind of explains a lot about magnetism. So we want to do something like that for machine learning, to have models that capture the important things and that we can understand better than the realistic situation. And so we would like to keep in mind this picture and build these models so that they reproduce the salient behavior that is observed in practice. And usually in physics, that would be an iterative process. We start with something clearly unrealistic, then we see what's missing and edit in and go on this way several times, hopefully arriving to something satisfactory. So what is such a model? What is an example of a model where we can start to understand what's going on? So the one that kind of has been studied a lot in the physics, statistical physics literature is this teacher-student setting. So you kind of simplify the question into, when can a neural network learn a teacher neural network? So how does this work? You create a teacher neural network. So for instance, here I have two hidden layers. It's a classical feedforward neural network with the input data X, with the output labels Y. The way I create it, I take the input data to be IID random, not only the sample from sample are IID, but also the components in each sample are IID from each other. Then I take some ground truth value of weights W star, also at random. And then with this, I generate labels. And this generates the data set, many samples of X and Y. And then one click at a time. And then the student network observes the Y and X, and it can or not observe the architecture of this network. So of course, the more it knows, the simpler it will be. But crucially, what it does know is the values of the weights. So it can have the same architecture or not. You know, that's object to be studied. And its goal is from the samples of X and Y to learn the same function. So not necessarily the same weights, but the same function. Okay, so here I kind of reduce the complicated question into something much simpler. You know, I kind of put aside the structure in the data. I said the data are IID random, right? I kind of define the function that I'm learning by saying that the Y's just come from something that I know. And I, you know, what remains there is the algorithmic question is whether it can be actually learned and from how many samples. So for physicists, this is a very kind of natural setting, natural idea. And indeed, you know, it's not like me who is introducing it now for you. It's 30, 40 years ago that this has been introduced in the physics literature, concretely in this paper by Gardner and Derrida, where it was called Model B, for whatever reason, in the simplest possible setting when the neural network does not even have hidden variables. So this would be just linear regression. You multiply your input data by a vector, then apply some nonlinear function on it, for instance, a sine, and this in this paper because that was kind of the popular nonlinearity back then. And then you're asking whether from the samples of X and Y you can learn back W, or a function that is equivalent to learning back the W star. All right? And you look at the high dimensional setting, because from a physics point of view, that's kind of the thermodynamic limit that in this case makes sense. When the number of samples is large and the dimension of the input space is also large, but they both go to infinity with some fixed ratio that I will call alpha, number of samples divided by dimension. And this is the thermodynamic limit, as any physicist would write it immediately for this model. From the point of view of statistics as a field, this is already very advanced because this is the high dimensional statistics. In statistics, usually 20 years ago, P was fixed and N would go to infinity. But sending them both to infinity, that's already challenging. And OK, so they introduced that model, but not only. So let me skip that. Not only they introduced that model, but them or the community or people close to them also solved it. Solved it in which sense? So for instance, in this paper by Geza Georgi, they looked at the case where the weights of the teacher are just plus minus ones. Okay, that ends up to be an interesting case. And what he computed in this paper with using the replica method, he derived in the thermodynamic limit this curve, which is the optimal generalization error that is achievable by any algorithm for that alpha, for that ratio between the number of samples and the dimension. And so no algorithm can do better. The question, is this algorithmically achievable, will come in a few slides. But what's interesting here, that this information is theoretically optimal generalization error, has an interesting behavior. It jumps at a certain value of alpha, that is this value, from some value to zero. So there is a phase transition. just like in the Ising model, where it is second order, here it's a first order phase transition in this learning curve, in the channelization error. So that's interesting, right, to physicists. Sorry? Gardner Derrida. So yes, and HE is Almeida Tellez, but I will call it ALG and IT later on. Well, okay. So there is a phase transition, so physicists start to get interested. And then, you know, another paper from Hamson Polinski, who will be here also later this week, I don't see him yet. Well, so, you know, the same year, the same problem, also arguing about reaching the perfect generalization error algorithmically, you know, linking it to metastability and things being spin glassy, hinting that it will maybe not be so easy, at least not immediately starting from this value. Okay, so I could literally spend the rest of my talk in those papers from the 80s and 90s, but that would maybe not be so interesting. So I will jump forward 40 years to what we know today about this model. So, yes?
What about the machine learning community at that time? Was it following? Because these were physics journals.
Yes, this is physics journals, but yeah, so NIPS didn't exist yet, but in the 90s when NIPS started existed, yeah, they all know each other. They all knew each other. Like, you know, for instance, even people that are not like from, say, the deep learning community, I, you know, randomly dined with Sejin Chandra Malik, who is like the main person in image processing in Berkeley. And when I told him where I come from, he was like, oh, so it's so interesting. I have the blue book by Hertz and, you know, on my desk. Yeah, they all knew each other. So it's kind of in the 2000s that it kind of, you know, the physicists really went to other things. And yeah, they. So of course, you know, not maybe like the core of the community, but the important people kind of knew about it. So, okay, so where are we today in terms of this model, this teacher-student setting for the generalized linear regression? That is the simplest case where I don't even have hidden units. I will of course come back to the hidden units in few slides. So first of all, you know, the activation function they were using back then was this sine or sigmoid. So today we are using ReLU. So the question is like, can you just write this theory for any activation function? And I showed you this example where the teacher prior is just binary, or it could be Gaussian, it could be something else, sparse. So can you make this a generic function? So yes, we can write a formula that has all that in. And there is this algorithmic question that was hinted in the Sompolinski paper. So, you know, in the 30 years that passed in between, we have a very good understanding of what's actually achievable in this simple problem with tractable algorithms, and that boils down to what's called the approximate message passing algorithm. And the third point is that this replica method has this kind of drawback that when you speak to the mathematicians' friends, you have to apologize that it's not rigorous, so they don't really know what it means. Okay, so, and the formulas are very explicit. So, but a lot of progress happened in the mathematics of proving these things. So that kind of, you know, led us to actually manage to prove that these formulas are correct. Those from the 90s in much more generality than they were actually written back then, which is all in this paper. So I just flash fast how this formula looks like. The formula for the generalization error goes through the free energy of the corresponding system in the corresponding limit that has some form where the terms are these pretty ugly integrals. But the key thing here is that it was originally a high dimensional problem. The p, the dimension was infinity. But here it's already in the limit where p and n went to infinity and the ratio is fixed. And it's written in terms of just scalar integrals. Right? So these are just scalar integrals, three of them. Maybe some of them can be explicitly computed if they are Gaussians. So this is something that you plug in Mathematica and you can evaluate it. And that's how I obtain these curves. Okay, and once you have the free energy, to physicists, you know, that's the moment generative function, so you can compute everything else from it, notably the optimal generalization error. That's just some other formula. Okay, the details, okay, I can show you later. And this approximate message passing algorithm, you know, it's an iterative algorithm that resembles a bit, if you know, about like variational mean field algorithms. But it has a particular term that the variational mean field algorithms do not have that makes it like exact in this thermodynamic limit, in the sense that we can actually predict what exactly its error at any given time, and that it has a close relation with the formula on the previous slide. So rather than going to details of that, I just show you the results of that to kind of show you the phenomenology, what's interesting. So here I'm back at my model. I'm plotting the generalization error again as a function of the number of samples per dimension. And this is the simplest case where the activation function is a sign, both in the teacher and the student. The weights of the t-charts is Gaussian, or spherical, no, nothing, not constrained, just something very generic. And the red line is the optimal error from the formula. The black dots is the performance of the approximate message passing algorithm on, I believe, 10,000 variables. And already for that size, it's on the line. Asymptotically, it has to be on the line. And the black blue squares is the classification by logistic regression. Just take scikit-learn, you write, make logistic regression on this data set. This is the generalization error you will get. Here, there is almost no gap. So if it was the case generically, we would be good. No, this is a simple problem.
How many steps are the
Till convergence. So typically that would be hundreds.
So this is a complex problem?
Yes. This is a simple problem. So now a bit more, you know, back to this case where the weights of the teacher were binary. So the theory that's exactly the same curve from the Georgia paper is this red curve. I just replotted it. It goes to zero at this alpha information theoretic that is the same alpha as before. Now, when we analyze the performance of the approximate message passing algorithm, that actually follows the dashed line that was also there in the George's paper, the metastable branch of that kind of fixed point equation that would kind of turn back here. And that exactly describes the performance of the approximate message passing algorithm. So notably, there is a gap between what the approximate message passing algorithm is able to do and what's information theoretically possible. The interesting thing, and that was the topic of my talk 8 years ago here, is that we actually believe that no other polynomial algorithm would be able to achieve the perfect generalization error in this region. Okay, but that would be for a different talk. It's just bypassing. It's a very interesting, like, theoretical computation complexity question. But here in the scope of our problem, it's like some small region of the phase diagram, so it's maybe not so, like, important. But what's...
relaxations or climbing up the ladder of
the like most powerful algorithms computer science currently has for which we can prove lower bounds, these SOS proofs stop exactly at the same point as the AMP. So that's kind of the you know, that goes beyond the physicist's intuition that there is really something going on. Yes? Right. So I was going to that. So as Maria is seeing, the logistic regression here is not picking at all this behavior. But, you know, it's also a bit like unfair to compare it because the approximate message passing knows about the model and knows about this prior and is using that, right? The logistic regression is very robust algorithm that you can use in any circumstances. Also, oh, I didn't say that. Yeah, I did say that, but I should stress that the approximate message passing, the theory works only if this matrix is IID random in both the directions. Of course, the logistic regression doesn't require that in any sense, and you know, the behavior of this algorithm would breaks typically out of that setting. We can fix it. That would be, again, for another talk, right? So we want to look at the algorithms that in practice we know are good, but what we want to understand is how their performance compares to what we can compute is optimal. And here it's not picking it up, okay, that the behavior can be better. So this we would need to understand.
Where would you put the error of the typical solution on this process?
Somewhere above.
Above what?
Well, this is the optimal.
Above the, no, compared to the other algorithm.
Yeah, I don't know. One would have to plot it. Have you done it? I mean, comparing this to the...
My opinion is very important because you would observe that any algorithm that works is going to have an error which is well below the error of the typical solutions. And so,
yes,
this is a very important message.
But the typical solutions, that's kind of the you know, I'm not saying, you know, okay, that's, Well, we debated that. I think that goes like the bias optimal estimator is actually not estimator in the sense that people, you know, it's not like a value of W's, right?
No, let's not talk about that. I totally agree on the optimal curve. I'm just saying now that you let's consider just algorithm that find one solution. So
yes.
Let's forget about that.
Ricardo will explain us in his talk what he means by that. Let's talk about it after. Okay. So, and another case here. Okay, I'll keep it binary, but now I change slightly the activation function. Yes?
Can you go back on?
Yes.
If you can. So these are model problems, and that's fine. Do you agree that hard? That's not very interesting. Do you agree? Am I getting the gist of it? Because you can give me 20% more data, and bang.
Yes, so yes and no. Okay, so I will not be talking about that in my talk, but Chiara will on Wednesday, that the fact that there is this hard phase actually has consequences of what's happening for the gradient descent here. So it actually is interesting. But I agree with you, if it was just like I need 20% more data, it would not be so interesting. But there is more into it than this. Good question. That actually, like, the fact that it is there actually is partially the reason why this one is not picking things up. But okay, normally that's a part of my talk, but in this conference it's Chiara covering it. So let's wait to her talk. Okay, so just changing a little bit the activation function, I just put the absolute value here and put some threshold so that still half of the labels are plus and half are minuses. Things can get really kind of hard, that the generalization error stays at just random guessing up to alpha that is one point something, and that the hard phase here is somewhat bigger in both the directions. And more than that, you know, the logistic regression does like nothing in this case. It's a classification problem, so we really had to go to somewhat deeper neural networks, and after playing with it a little bit, some like three-layer neural network, you know, I had to put it in the input because I need to change the scale of the alpha. Like, whereas the approximate message passing at alpha roughly 1.5 starts to do perfectly, the neural network kind of around 10 picks that there is something and would go to zero very slowly. So, you know, if I like play a little bit with things, I can make things much more adversarial. So, of course, this is not like interesting in practice, just to say that there is a zoology of behavior that we need to understand. What the function here is, how does it influence the behavior of the algorithms? So that's kind of the interesting thing. Okay. So let's stop for a little bit. First of all, for questions, if there are some. And let me kind of be a bit critical with myself, right? So I showed you like nice results about the generalized linear regression, what we can understand about it. I didn't go into the math, but mathematically it's nice that we can prove these things, etc. But is this bringing us towards the theory of deep learning? Okay, so to answer, let me go back to my schematic here. And so what I told you, I want to stop there, yes. So what I told you is the blue thing. On the structure of the data, what I did is I took the inputs IID and the outputs were generated by a teacher. I had no hidden units, so no deep, not, you know, multi-layers, no hidden units whatsoever. And the algorithm I was talking about that we understand well is this approximate message passing. And the other algorithms I was showing you, that was just running it, right? There was no analysis, no understanding. So what we would like to have instead, this is so sensitive, I should have taken mine. What we would like to understand instead is on the algorithmic side to understand what the gradient descent based algorithms are doing. And that's what, I can't believe it. And that's where Gerard and Chiara will be talking about tomorrow, actually. Maybe I can just switch it. No, because I have mine, maybe if I just switch it, let me bother it. But I don't know where it is. Okay. Well, never mind. I'll try to be careful. On the structured data size, so we, you know, that's another direction along which we are working, and Mark Mazel will be talking about it on Thursday. So wait for that. And then the rest of my talk, the remaining, say, 20 minutes and something, I will tell you what we currently know how to do in this direction of putting in the hidden variables and where we are stuck. Okay? what we can do and where we are stuck. So about that. So first of all, we can put in hidden variables. And there's nothing new. Again, you know, this model called the committee machine comes again from the papers in the 90s. So notably, this is a solution with the replica method of this committee machine. What the committee machine is, again, within this teacher-student framework. So it's the same as before. But now I'm adding in a few hidden variables. I can have multiple layers if I want. But the crucial thing is that the thermodynamic limit in which I know how to solve things is, so as before, the number of samples and the dimension go to infinity with a fixed ratio. And the number of hidden variables is order one. It's not going to infinity. So it's a large system, and I have like 10 hidden variables. And they can be in few layers if you want, or just one. But they only have to be few of them. So in this limit, we can write, you know, analogous formula, a closed form solution for what is the optimal generalization error. And that actually has been done in this paper. What we did in this paper last year is that we proved that that formula is correct up to like a little caveat. We have the approximate message passing that is matching it or not, depending on its analysis. And we kind of wrote it for a bigger class of activation functions and priors. And already from doing something like that, like already in the simplest possible non-trivial case with two hidden units, we can actually start learning something, some behavior that we kind of know from practice. We can see it in this model. So what this picture is kind of saying, plotting certain things about the solution of the model, is putting in evidence what is called the specialization phase transition, which is a well-defined value of this alpha, such that if you have fewer samples than that, then provably the best method to use is just linear regression. And if you have more samples than that, then it's actually better to use two hidden units, and you will reach a better performance than if you were only using linear regression. And this is something that practitioners know, right? If you have very few samples, you know that deep learning is not very useful, that doing just kernel regression is what you should do. And only in problems and data sets where you do have many samples, you have a decent chance that deep learning will actually be bringing something in, better performance. So, of course, the value of this alpha is not predicting the value in practice, like in the same sense that the Ising critical temperature is not 700 Kelvin or something like that, whatever it is in real materials. But the concept is there, already in the simplest case.
The data here was also unstructured.
Yeah, the inputs are unstructured, IID, yes. And, okay, yeah, that's a good slide. And another thing that you can learn now in the thermodynamic limit, but when the number of hidden units now is larger, and when it's going to infinity, that's actually when the equation simplifies, so you can actually analyze them better. You again put in evidence this algorithmic gap, this time between, again, the information theoretically optimal performance and the performance you get from the approximate message passing. And here you learn that it's actually rather large. That whereas information theoretically, the number of samples you need is just some constant times the number of hidden units times the dimension, algorithmically you need some other constant times square of the number of hidden units times the dimension. So if the teacher had many hidden units, you are losing that number here, which, you know, in the picture means that there is a big computational gap. And the gradient descent based algorithms, you know, kind of anticipating from the previous pictures, would be needing even more, but those we didn't analyze yet. So you can already learn interesting things in this very simple model. Another thing that we can and did analyze about this committee machine, so again the same model, the teacher-student scenario, we can analyze the one-pass stochastic gradient descent. And again, that's something that has been done in the 90s. The notable kind of well-known paper is this one by Saad and Sola, where they write in the thermodynamic limit, again, for order n, for order one hidden units, they write a closed set of ODEs that you know, describe the dynamics of the stochastic gradient descent. So in which setting? In the setting where I have like infinite number of samples and I take them one by one and I never take any second time. So right. So while by now I was really paying attention to how many samples I have, and I was trying to make it as small as possible, here I kind of put completely aside the sample complexity. I have infinitely many samples. And even here, so we kind of what we did in this paper this year is that we proved that these equations are actually correct. You know, just it was in a sense a very straightforward extension of what Yulu did. So kind of the development that has been done in other problems in proving things about how to analyze this dynamics. We just took it from there. And we wrote a formula for the generalization error as a function of, you know, many things that you can have here now. The which layer is learned, the different activations, the learning rate, the label noise, the initialization, and the number of hidden units in the teacher and students. So you have like 8 or whatever different parameters, and you know, I'm not really showing like a detailed account of our results, but in one sentence it's complicated. Even for this very simple model, like we can see many different behaviors, and you know, I refer you to the paper if you kind of want to learn about that. Or to NeurIPS, where it will be presented. And you know, to somehow continue in this line, this slide is about what we don't know how to do. So what would be the next kind of thing we would want to do is to look at the following limit that kind of looks very reasonable. When we are actually having number of hidden units here, that would be the small k that is large, and that is growing proportionally with the number of samples and with the dimension. And yes, and also the number of output units. Here I don't make it one, I make it large. This kind of is a setting where on the input I have order p square numbers, on the output I have order p square numbers, and the weights on matrices with order p square parameters. So information theoretically, this is like a meaningful thermodynamic limit in which this model should have a non-trivial behavior as the number of samples, as the corresponding constant here is changed. So we would like to be able to compute the generalization error for this model, you know, to plot these curves, and then start to be talking about how things depend on the various parameters. But this is something that we don't know how to do. Even on the level of this non-rigorous replica method, we don't know how to write a closed solution for this model. So this is the open problem that is kind of blocking us from getting more realistic on the side of making the architecture really multi-layer with, say, 20 hidden layers and changing their width and looking at things like that. Okay. So this we don't know how to do, but there is still something interesting we can do, you know, many interesting things we can do in the multi-layer setting. And let me explain it here. So we call it the multi-layer generalized linear model. So I just told you that what we don't know how to do is to kind of look at it as the neural network, where there is some teacher that chose W's and then generated X's and Y's, and then from the samples of X's and Y's, we should be learning the W's or something equivalent that gives us the same function. So this we don't know how to analyze. But the other thing, if actually you already did that and you gave me W's, you could also be asking a question: if you gave me the W's and also Y, could you invert the neural network and compute the X? Of course, if you have X, then you just push it forward, you can compute Y, that's easy, right? But is the inverse problem also easy? If, say, you know, if Y is just a label, no, but if, say, Y is a whole sequence, you know, can you get X back from the Y?
You want to grow the
data? Yeah, I want to, so I will go to the motivation of why that is interesting, right? Here is just like mathematically. Mathematically, this we can solve. We do have a formula, not for like any matrices W here, but for the case where the matrices W are random, IID, and independent from each other. We have a formula for the optimal solution and the corresponding algorithm and the corresponding proof, almost. Okay, there are some details missing, but morally. So why is this interesting, right? Well, I mean, as Jari is asking, what's okay? So what can we do with that? So two things that we can do with that. This one I will tell you more about. This one is that those of you that follow this theory of information bottleneck, where you can perhaps understand something about deep learning by computing the mutual information between different layers and thinking about how it changes and how it depends during the learning, There have been interesting hypotheses about it put forward. We still don't know whether they are true or not, or in which sense they are true. But kind of the bottleneck in validating that theory, or even testing it, or perhaps correcting it, is that computing these mutual informations is computationally expensive to start with. So how can we test it if we don't know how to compute the key quantity it actually uses? So with the formula that we have, we actually can compute the mutual information between different layers. We need to change slightly the way the learning is done. Okay, but this is something interesting that we have done and presented at NeurIPS last year. So if you're interested in information bottleneck and mutual informations, so you can go to that paper. And a second thing that we can do about this formula is we can write a theory for estimation problems with generative neural network priors. So now this maybe doesn't mean anything to you, so let me walk you through what this is and why is it interesting. So this is like a generic slide about what's signal processing, right? When, say, I don't know, you go to hospital and they give you an MRI scanner, they want to know kind of the density and the type of tissue, the 3D picture of it in your body. But rather than measuring that, what they measure many Fourier transform projections of that issue of the absorption coefficient or that issue, right? They measure something about the map of the tissue in your body, some linear transformation of it. But then after they measured it, they need to solve the inverse problem from the measurement inverting to get the picture that the doctor then looks at. So there is a lot of like inverse problems in many areas that can be kind of formalized. You have a vector in p dimensions, you apply some operator on it, you measure the result, but then you want to know to estimate the v from the from the y. So the typical examples of such problems would be denoising, when you are simply adding noise, or linear inverse problem, where you are multiplying by a matrix here, or the spiked matrix estimation, where you are taking the vector times its transpose and you add a lot of noise and observe the result of that. And the basic paradigm in like 90% of work on signal processing is that the signal you are measuring is not just arbitrary, there is some structure in it. And if you leverage the structure, then you can actually solve these problems computationally efficiently. And the kind of typical structure that is used is a sparsity of this V, right? So there has been 20 years of work in signal processing on compressed sensing, on sparse principal component analysis, where this assumed structure is sparsity, and you show that you can do algorithmically very well and solve really interesting problems. But since like several years now, there is kind of a change of this paradigm, that instead of supposing that this vector is sparse, you suppose that it comes from a generative model, imagine a GAN, generative neural network, with input to the network that has a small dimension. So there is some dimensional reduction there. So the sparsity would kind of correspond to the dimension of this input vector. And then this is a way to represent the signals, V. So kind of the first paper that kind of put that into, you know, concrete terms that I know of is by the group of Laurent Chakala and some of, you know, our common students, where they used as the generative model a restricted Boltzmann machine, and they show that on something like MNIST they can indeed solve compressed sensing with this restricted Boltzmann machine prior much more efficiently than when they were assuming that the MNIST is sparse in some wavelet basis, which it is, but that's the Boltzmann machine was more efficient representation. So they need, like, they can support more noise or fewer measurements. You know, it's improving quite universally the signal processing in pretty much all applications. The paper that kind of is very well known and that really pushed it into the state of the art in terms of the generative models, because they used variational autoencoders and generative adversarial networks as the prior, is this paper by Bora, Jalal, Price, and Dimakis, where they, on like some celebrity data set, this is probably too small, but they show that, you know, the standard methods to denoise and compress sense these images are just so much worse than if you just train a standard GAN in the way machine learning people do it and do the signal processing with that as a prior. And here, I show you a slide by Soledad, because she also will be here later this week. And she did a different generative model, but I kind of like what she wrote on her blog. Generative models are the new sparsity, because sparsity is a huge subfield of signal processing. And so if generative models are new sparsity, it means there's a lot that will come out from this area. And so the question is, so it works great. Now, it's very difficult to actually write a theory that takes into account that that's the prior. So our contribution here is to actually think about that theory. And in the paper that I was citing, we focused on this spiked matrix estimation. And just like one slide about what's known about this sparse spiked matrix estimation, which is also sometimes called sparse PCA. So it's like PCA, but the vector you're looking for should be sparse, so have many zeros. So you cannot just compute the eigenvector, because that one is not sparse. So in the theory, this model is mostly known because it has this algorithmic gap that I was describing. It is here as well, and it's very large. And that's kind of one of the main models where this gap is studied. And it's very like intriguing why it's there, and there are very interesting connections in the theoretical computer science about this gap. So that's kind of the key thing about sparse PCA, that there is a huge gap between what's information theoretically possible and what's algorithmically possible. Now, so this, you know, we also have some papers on that, but there will be other papers to cite here that are much more classical in the stat literature. Now, if instead of taking sparse prior, you take a prior that says that the spike that you're putting in actually comes from a generative neural network with the input that is in k dimensions and the matrices that are IID and independent from each other, so not learned by a GAN, but that's kind of the modeling assumption here. We can write the theory for these matrices that are random. And what we can get from that is the following. So here is just to say that, you know, again, as when we are writing these closed form formulas for the free energy, here we actually realize by kind of going through the proof of how we would show these things that there is a kind of a Lego principle here. Like if we can solve the outer model and if we can solve and write the free energy for the prior, then we can put them together. And this is kind of what this slide is saying. So it's writing the corresponding free energy of the model of interest with the generative prior in terms of the free energy of the generative prior. But that's itself a model with a generative prior, so then we can iterate and write the corresponding formula. So I was just explaining here. And this is actually a paper from 2 years ago where we wrote the corresponding formula for this generative model. So we know how to, you know, write the theory for that. And here is just one result. So for instance, when I take this estimation of V star from Y, this is a lot of noise here, and delta here is the variance of this noise. So the bigger delta, the harder it will be. And now this V star just comes from a single layer generative model that is simply sine of a random matrix times a vector X, okay? And the ratio, the aspect ratio of this matrix, that's this alpha here, P over K. So okay, these pictures, like, kind of, it probably is a bit of a headache if you have never seen it, what these parameters are. But in words, what this picture is saying is that in this whole triangle, if you actually were not considering the generative prior, is this, like the classical methods that are not taking it into account, such as if you just did PCA on this matrix Y, then you would not be able to get any correlation with the ground truth signal in this triangle. And if you take this into account, you can. Okay, so it's improving the performance, so that's what you expected, so nothing special here. But what is crucial here is that if I actually plot the error as a function of the noise, I have here nice curves where the error is like very small and then there is some intermediate behavior and then I do just as bad as randomly guessing. But the key point here is that there are never jumps in these curves. And this hard phase, this algorithmic gap, is always related to first order phase transitions. So to the facts where, to the cases where the order parameter jumps discontinuously. And in this case with the generative prior, I was bugging my students for 3 weeks about, you know, not believing them. So there must be a gap. There is a bug in your code, go back. And they were keeping coming back saying, we just don't see the gap. And then we concluded, you know, there is no gap, and did like more work on that to actually confirm that, etc. And indeed, if you take the generative prior, there is no gap. The gap disappears. And okay, how am I, you know, justifying that? I write the corresponding message passing algorithm that also kind of follows this Lego principle. If I can write it for one model and the other, I can put the two modules together. And it's like very nice actually, even for the coding. I mean, it's very modular, like it's you know, kind of this Lego principle is true both for the proof and the theory, and also when you're actually implementing this algorithm. And the analysis of this algorithm, that actually tells me that the algorithm will achieve exactly the performance, the information theoretic performance, for all the values of the parameters. So the gap disappears. So that's kind of interesting. So while this sparse PCA is like a canonical example of a problem where the gap is huge and is studied a lot in theory, if instead of using sparsity as prior, I use generative model with random weights. So of course, if the weights are learned, we don't know yet, but that's what we could do so far, then this gap completely disappears. So this is kind of making us suggest the questions, are generative priors even better than sparsity, because they would be algorithmically friendlier. So this is so far, of course, a question, because we only analyze it for random weights, and we would have to do the theory for the learned weights, which is much harder. But it's a very intriguing question. And with that, I'm close to the end of my talk. I guess my high-level conclusion for, you know, for the rest of the week, we will hear a lot about that, that physics has many useful tools applicable in high-dimensional inference and learning. And when we are talking about that, I would like to argue that we need to keep in mind this diagram where I was talking about this site, and many people will be talking about other sites. And what's kind of nice about the statistical physics approach is that while in each of these directions we are not very far yet, we are having them all three in the same framework. So in this sense, it's kind of, that's why I believe that we are kind of, that it's really interesting to look at that, because we have all of them taken into account. And this is just the site with the references if you want to read more. These are the papers on which I was talking, on the generalized linear model, the committee machine, the online committee machine, and the generative priors, and the paper on the mutual informations in deep learning. And I also put there here a paper that I was not talking about, but for this audience, I think you want to know about it. It's a review that we wrote with a bunch of people in different fields of physics applying machine learning to physics. Some of them are here, that will soon appear in reviews of modern physics. And with this, if there are more questions, I'm happy to answer them.